Hello, lovely listener. I'm your host, Lindsay, and you're listening to Two Cents Podcast, your Audible anthology. This episode is a deep dive into feminism in poetry. Historically, literature has been a male-dominated sphere, and any poetry written by a woman could be seen as feminist. However, we will discover the progression of this ideology and the literature it was born of. With that being said, cue the intro. Before we get into the episode, I'd like to brief you on some things. For one, this was a long-term project, and I feel it necessary to say that my mindset when I started is completely different from how I finished. And I give credit to knowledge. As vague as that sounds, it truly is power. So you may or may not pick up that change as the episode progresses. As this episode is about feminism, I do talk a bit about sex and gender. There are parts where I use them interchangeably, but now I am aware of their differences and acknowledge them as separate entities. I am very open to correction if I misinterpret something or get a fact wrong, so you are welcome to check me up on my claims. There may be a slight change in how I sound. That's due to me recording the episode in segments at different times of the day over many days. You can find the episode transcript on the website along with a little gallery slideshow thing where you can put a face to the poets and thinkers that I mention in the episode. I'm not tech savvy, so this is a problem I'm still working on, but if you view the gallery on a desktop, you'll be able to see captions of the photographs. But that's not the case when you view it on your mobile. Hopefully that'll change soon. If it helps, I've arranged the photos in the order that I mention the poets or thinkers, so I think you'd be able to put two and two together. If you haven't already, please sign up for the newsletter to be notified when an episode is released, and be sure to confirm your subscription. I have added timestamps or time markers. I'm not sure if they'll appear on the platform you're using, but they are on the website and they will be on YouTube in a few days when I upload the episode there. That out of the way, let us begin. First and foremost, let's talk about isms, because we will have many more poetic inquiries on various isms in episodes to come. So, what is this suffix about? As a noun, an ism is defined as a distinctive practice, system, or philosophy, typically a political ideology or an artistic movement. As a suffix, it can denote an action, as seen in the word criticism, the quality or state of a subject, as seen in the word pessimism, an ideology, like this episode's topic, feminism, or something pathological, again, feminism. Cracks aside, the real example is necrophilism. Now, I am crazy about etymology, so I'm going to ramble a bit about the origins of the word. Ism traces back to Latin, specifically the suffix isma or ismus, which have trickled down to the Romance and some Germanic tongues. Other sources have stated that it is derived from the ancient Greek suffix ismos, which entwined with the Latin isma and ismus, once more influencing the languages we know today. Isma, ismus, or ismos mean an imitation of or siding with, say, an artistic movement, a behavior, philosophy, religion, social movement, or theory, as was mentioned in the definition. I think it's also important to note that an ism typically refers to a concept on a broader scale. I'm probably not the only one, but the mention of certain isms used to rub me the wrong way. Reflecting on it now, it was pretty ignorant of me to get provoked, only knowing or hearing about the surface of something. So this episode is on feminism. We are yet to explore the various waves of feminism and the isms that fall under it. Ramble over, let's get into the history. Feminism is broadly defined as the belief in economic, political, and social equality of the sexes. It's widely thought to be a Western creation. However, it has made its way around the world, attending to women's rights and interests. When I think of the first feminist movement, the first idea that comes to mind is the women's suffrage in the 20th century. But feminism, or feminist thought, goes further back than that. In the 3rd century BCE, Roman women filled the Capitoline Hill, which was a fortress and asylum, blocking all of its entrances in protest against a consul's rule to limit their use of expensive goods. The consul commented on the women protesting and is quoted as saying, "If they are victorious now, what will they not attempt? As soon as they begin to be your equals, they will have become your superiors." That's remarkable, seeing that for a large part of history, women's liberties were incredibly restricted. Public life was solely for men, and even as it opened up to women, they were always in the shadow of a male. For quite some time, feminism was kept alive by individuals or small groups who were more outspoken, and its ideals were expressed largely in publications rather than being sounded off. Christine de Pizan is one such individual, a French feminist thinker from the 15th century who authored feminist works including The Tale of Joan of Arc, the iconic Maid of Orleans. From reading her quotes, she placed great emphasis on women and girls being educated to the same degree as men and boys, that they may delight in knowledge and use it to appreciate the world around them as much as men and boys could. Here are some quotes from her book titled The Book of the City of Ladies. "If it were customary to send daughters to school like sons, and if they were then taught the natural sciences, they would learn as thoroughly and understand the subtleties of all the arts and sciences as well as sons." Another quote of hers reads, "The man or the woman in whom resides greater virtue is the higher. Neither the loftiness nor the lowliness of a person lies in the body according to the sex, but in the perfection of conduct and virtue." This was quite profound, but it's obvious now that conduct or virtue is not a matter of gender, but it makes you think about how men and women were viewed in regards to their ability to uphold virtue in that period. That being so, let's delve into the first wave of feminism.
When a new century was born in 1900, woman's place was in the home. Few sports and few jobs were considered ladylike enough for her attention. The amply padded and well-corseted young woman who strolled in New York's Easter Parade of 1903 was supposed to be a companion, not a competitor to man.
We're clearly soldiers in petty coats and dauntless crusaders for women's votes. Though we adore men individually, we agree that as a group they're rather stupid.
Mrs. Banks!
Cast off the shackles of yesterday, shoulder to shoulder into the fray. Our daughters' daughters will adore us, and they'll sing in grateful chorus. Well done, sister suffragette.
Be that as it may, I do not...
The first wave of feminism began around the 15th century. It is the longest one that was kept alive by a small number of thinkers until it gained traction in the late 19th century and early 20th century. The main objective of feminists in this era was to undo the prevailing perspective that women were property. This perspective prevented women from receiving an education and thus being involved in public life. Essentially, they were born and bred to be wed. Laura Chirita, who succeeded Christine de Pizan, was a 15th century Venetian feminist writer who wrote a volume of letters titled Collected Letters of a Renaissance Feminist. The letters state the complaints of women regarding their denial of education, their suppression under marriage, and the superficiality of women's clothing. A quote from one of the letters reads, "Empty women who strive for no good, but exist to adorn themselves. These women of majestic pride, fantastic coiffures, outlandish ornament, and necks bound with gold or pearls, bear the glittering symbols of their captivity to men." On one hand, there is some othering and generalization in this quote by deeming the women who adorn themselves as empty and regarding the gold and pearls they wear as glittering symbols of their captivity to men. Othering isn't a good route for unification, but on the other hand, she is revealing that this was the apex for women, to be objects destined for frivolous adornment. Significantly, both women lost their husbands earlier in their lives, and most of their popular works were produced after the fact. Eventually, literary works in defense of women became a genre, which was mostly concentrated in Venice and France. The main narrative continued to be the demand for women's education, as well as the demand for women to be seen as moral and intellectual equals to men. However, on the backdrop of a religious society, most feminist writers produced religious pieces and used religion to justify their stances. Listen to this quote by Venetian poet Moderata Fonte. "Men were created before women, but that doesn't prove their superiority. Rather, it proves ours, for they were born out of the lifeless earth in order that we could be born out of living flesh. And what's so important about this priority in creation anyway? When we are building, we lay foundations on the ground first, things of no intrinsic merit or beauty, before subsequently raising up sumptuous buildings and ornate palaces. Lowly seeds are nourished in the earth, and then later the ravishing blooms appear. Lovely roses blossom forth, and scented narcissi." This is from a book published after her death by her uncle, titled The Worth of Women, wherein is clearly revealed their nobility and their superiority to men. For most of her life, she produced religious pieces such as The Passion of Christ, a poem wherein she focuses on the Virgin Mary and Mary Magdalene. She was noted by her husband to have been an outstanding homemaker. Once she settled down, she willfully let go of her literary career to focus on building a home and family. She later succumbed to complications following the birth of her fourth child. So despite there being anthologies of medieval feminist works, a woman's role in society didn't change for a long time. That was until feminist thought got to England in the 16th century, where the true nature of womanhood was being debated. This also resulted in secularist thought joining the conversation. Cue the Enlightenment. Never before had there been a unified movement of women demanding reform. The world as they knew it was changing, but only significantly for men. The wives, sisters, and daughters of the common man were bystanders to monuments like the Declaration of the Rights of Man and Citizen in France, and still regarded as silly and subordinates in the mind of philosophers like Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Though the man on the street was declared an equal by law, this law still excluded women. The centuries-old conversation on equal education and opportunity prevailed, with Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley being a notable speaker on this issue in England. Much like her other half, Percy Bysshe Shelley, she was a prolific writer. Here's a poem by her titled Stanzas. "Oh, come to me in dreams, my love. Oh, come to me in dreams, my love. I will not ask a dearer bliss. Come with the starry beams, my love, and press mine eyelids with thy kiss. 'Twas thus, as ancient fables tell, love visited a Grecian maid till she disturbed the sacred spell and woke to find her hopes betrayed. But gentle sleep shall veil my sight, and Psyche's lamp shall darkling be, when, in the visions of the night, thou dost renew thy vows to me. Then come to me in my dreams, my love. I will not ask a dearer bliss. Come with the starry beams, my love, and press mine eyelids with thy kiss. There is nothing particularly feminist about this piece. It's merely a sample from a woman who believed that making women rational and free would make them more virtuous and wise. Our first feminist poet is Aphra Behn, a 17th century poet and playwright. She wrote 15 plays and is regarded to be one of the best playwrights of the Restoration period. Her poems weren't as great, but the poetry in her plays fared better than individual pieces. A little bit on her life. She was born in 1640. Her earliest years are a blur, however, at age 15, she married a wealthy Dutch merchant who had connections to the monarch Charles II. He passed away during the Great Plague in 1665. Following her husband's death, Behn was appointed as a spy in Holland by the monarch and created the name Astrea, which she also published under. Unfortunately, the spy gig backfired and her superiors weren't paying her, so she had to devise all sorts of plans to get back to England, which involved drowning herself in debt. Her outstanding payments landed her in jail, but not long after, she was assisted by her future lover, a lawyer named John Hoyle, who was the muse of many of her sonnets. After leaving prison, she was, quote, determined to dedicate the rest of her life to pleasure and to letters and to trust her own devices, rather than to rely upon others whom she could not trust. She went on to have a career with many ups and downs, the downs being influenced by how superiors felt about her work. One incident involved a prologue in one of her plays that offended the monarch's opponents. Their reaction caused her economic hardship, which forced her to take a hiatus. She is quoted as saying, "If I must not, because of my sex, have this freedom, I lay down my quill, and you shall hear no more from me." Critics and biographers have stated that the most attractive quality of her lyrical pieces is their spontaneity, demonstrating to the reader or theatergoer that the best poetry doesn't need to be centered around learning, but can succeed because the lines are memorable, singable, and direct. Now I will read to you The Willing Mistress by Aphra Behn. Amyntas led me to a grove where all the trees did shade us. The sun itself thought it had strove, but it could not have betrayed us. The place secured from human eyes, no other fear allows, but when the winds that gently rise do kiss the yielding boughs. Down there we sat upon the moss, and I'd begin to play a thousand amorous tricks to pass the heat of all the day. And many kisses he did give, and I returned the same, which made me willing to receive that which I dare not name. His charming eyes no aid required to tell their softening tale. On her that was already fired, 'twas easy to prevail. He did but kiss and clasp me round, whilst those his thoughts expressed, and laid me down gently on the ground. Ah, who can guess the rest? That was a pretty fun read. For all she had endured, she had quite the wit. Behn makes some interesting allusions in this piece that defy the meek and modest disposition of a regular 17th century woman. Her allusions summon a discussion on female sensuality and the freedom of expression it was allowed. Seeing that it was the 17th century, it was most likely taboo, but it proves to be an important discussion in feminism. Bain reminds me somewhat of Beatrice from Shakespeare's Much Ado About Nothing, which was published in the same century. I consider Beatrice to be a feminist character. Much like her, Bain had a liberal take on love and marriage for her time. She was full of wit, but retained a girlish spirit. By the 18th and 19th century, feminism had influence in Germany, France, and the USA. It was then given a political spin, and more women came forward and voiced their matters. Le Voix de Femme, translated as The Voice of Women, was a daily newspaper published by Parisian feminists that shed light on women's rights around the world. They were also inspired by anti-slavery activists. This is an early, yet subtle example of feminism and intersectionality. We'll touch on that later. Focusing in on the United States, in the late 1840s, feminist fervor was on the rise, and conventions led to a redrafting of the Declaration of Independence, adding in the most daring resolution, giving women the right to vote. This was led by Lucretia Mott, who was a preacher, and championed by a former slave named Frederick Douglass, another taste of intersectionality. The resolutions were passed, but Mott didn't speak for a lot of women. See, one major criticism directed at the first wave of feminism is the fact that it was riddled with discrimination, and only the concerns of upper-class white women were taken into account. Sojourner Truth, a former slave who focused more on slavery abolition than feminism, delivered her renowned "Ain't I a Woman" speech at a women's convention in 1851. A large portion of the speech expressed the estrangement women like her felt towards women at the forefront fighting for women's rights. Here's an excerpt from her speech. "That man over there says that women need to be helped into carriages and lifted over ditches and to have the best place everywhere. Nobody ever helps me into carriages or over mud puddles or gives me any best place. And ain't I a woman? Look at me. Look at my arm. I have plowed and planted and gathered into barns, and no man could head me. And ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man, when I could get it, and bear the lash as well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen most all sold off to slavery. And when I cried out with my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman?" That was pretty moving to read. And she made a profound point. Having said that, the feminist fervor was quelled at the wake of the American Civil War, but when it was revived, it came back stronger than ever, steadfast with the women's suffrage heading the agenda. After all the strife in the early 20th century, the women's suffrage movement transformed its polite approach to a combative one by boycotting, bombing, picketing, and other demonstrations. Albeit this was led by a more progressive faction. The right for women to vote was introduced in Britain in 1918, and in 1920, America declared the 19th Amendment, guaranteeing all American women the right to vote. This was a great triumph for feminism that would become the global standard over time. The following poem by Charlotte Perkins Gilman celebrates this fact, but it is also an important marker for what feminism was about in the first wave. I'm going to read it and analyze it stanza by stanza because it's quite lengthy. Here it is. "We as Women" by Charlotte Perkins Gilman.
"Mm-hmm. There is a cry in the air about us. We heard it before, behind, of the way in which we, as women, are going to lift mankind.
The poem begins optimistically, probably fueled by the romance of achieving such a great feat. But the tale of feminism will show that true liberty and female influence was still a far reach.
With our white frocks starched and ruffled, and our soft hair brushed and curled, hats off, for we as women are coming to save the world.
Here she is promoting femininity, as she suggests that women can save the world as they are, in their white frocks and curled hair. This brings to question the, air quotes, unfeminine tactics that were used in part to get their victory. You know, the bombing and things alike.
Fair sisters, listen one moment and perhaps you'll pause for 10. The business of women as women is only with men as men.
She is once again taking pride in femininity and makes a distinction between the sexes, whilst also showing their need for each other.
What we do, we as women, we have done all through our life. The work that is ours as women is the work of mother and wife.
Very fitting for the time, once again the idea that women were born and bred to be wed. And despite the emerging defiance of these traditional roles, the speaker is endorsing them.
But to elevate public opinion and to lift up erring man is the work of the human being. Let us do it, if we can.
Here the speaker is calling for a unified effort from men and women to better the world, reinforcing the fact that virtue isn't a matter of gender. It is the work of the human being.
But wait, warm-hearted sisters, not quite so fast so far. Tell me, how are we going to lift a thing any higher than we are? We are going to purify politics and to elevate the press. We enter the foul paths of the world to sweeten, cleanse, and bless.
These stanzas illustrate the ambition and the excitement that was in the atmosphere. We are going to do this, we are going to do that. However, the speaker tones it down by stating that there will be limits, and these limits seem to be based on their idea of what women are meant to do. Sweeten, cleanse, and bless.
To hear the high things we are going to do, and the horrors of man we tell, one would think we as women were angels, and our brothers were fiends of hell. We, that were born of one mother, and reared in the selfsame place, in the school and the church together, we of one blood, one race.
Here the speaker urges women not to demonize men. The men who are their brothers at heart, whom they shared their earliest years with. The victory should not cause a rift between them. I thought the last line, we of one blood, one race, meant humanity as a whole, you know, the human race. But interestingly, Gilman believed in racial purity, stating that she was an Anglo-Saxon before everything.
Now then, all forward together, but remember, everyone, that 'tis not by feminine innocence that the work of the world is done. The world needs strength and courage and wisdom to help and feed. When we as women bring these to man, we shall lift the world indeed.
The speaker calls for unity between men and women once again by highlighting the general strengths of each gender. Strength and courage to men, and the wisdom to help and feed to women, and how they come together to make the world a better place. From this, it's safe to assume that the first wave of feminism generally embraced traditional roles, acknowledged the differences between the sexes whilst embracing those differences and how they could come together for the betterment of the world. Now we are taking our inquiry eastwards to Japan to relish the works of Akiko Yosano. She was born in 1878 in Sakai, Japan, and is the greatest female poet and tanka poet in Japan's modern history. A tanka poem consists of 5 lines comprising the following number of syllables. 5 syllables in the first line, 7 in the second line, 5 in the third line, 7 in the fourth line, and 7 syllables in the fifth line. A feminist, a pacifist, and an instigator for social reform in the early 1900s, Yosano's name is synonymous with Japanese romanticism. She lives on as the princess, the queen, and the goddess of poetry in Japan. She was brought up with her parents' traditional beliefs. Nevertheless, her natural curiosity led her to the libraries of her great-grandparents, where she cultivated her literary skills. Eroticism and imaginative passion permeate each line of her pieces, as she was determined to fill each one of them with emotion. This is a reflection of her life, in which she strove to live purposefully and colorfully. Alongside establishing a culture school for girls, she produced extensive work on women's social causes with her husband, Hiroshi Yosano, which she gained from financially. In spite of her financial success, she was still passionate about justice and speaking up for those who were oppressed, even if it meant defying her own people. An example being her mourning for Chinese boy soldiers who were killed by the Japanese in Shanghai. At times, she'd be an outcast for her beliefs and work, but it didn't break her stride. Yosano was also well-traveled, and on her travels around Europe, she was taken aback by the relative freedoms European women had, which inspired her to be a force for change back in Japan. Even after her husband's passing, she remained focused in her activities and craft, consistently producing work all the while raising her 13 children, 11 of whom would make it to adulthood. She died from a stroke, aged 64, in 1942. All in all, she's produced 17,000 tanka poems and over 500 free verse poems. Before we get into the poem, it's important that we talk about English translations. English translations aren't fully able to capture the nuances of the Japanese language, let alone Yosano's layered innuendos. I'm reading a quote from the book Feminist Poets to elaborate on her writing style. Akiko's poetry is characterized by lyric, rhetorical, dramatic, and narrative strength. Each poem expresses an intense feeling of a particular moment in the poet's life, a feeling that is often too subtle, complex, or ambiguous to be fully comprehended by Westerners unfamiliar with the nuances of Japanese sensibility. The rhetorical thrust of many of Akiko's poems can readily be understood. However, especially in those poems concerned with dramatic conflict between lovers, with the plight of women generally, and with protests against social conventions, the drama of Akiko's stormy life concentrated in the tanka reveals the intricate story of her romance, marriage, and literary career. Thus, a study of her collections as unified works is usually more fruitful than formal analysis of individual poems. It's safe to say that this isn't the last time you'll be hearing of Akiko Yosano, because it's only right that we gather enough poems to explore them as unified works. For now, I have a translated poem titled Labor Pains. It is one of her free verse poems, and I am reading it to you now. I am sick today, sick in my body. Eyes wide open, silent. I lie on the bed of childbirth. Why do I, so used to the nearness of death, to pain and blood and screaming, now uncontrollably tremble with dread? A nice young doctor tried to comfort me and talked about the joy of giving birth, since I know better than he about this matter. What good purpose can his prattle serve? Knowledge is not reality. Experience belongs to the past. Let those who lack immediacy be silent. Let observers be content to serve. I am all alone, totally, utterly, entirely on my own, gnawing my lips, holding my body rigid, waiting on inexorable fate. There is only one truth. I shall give birth to a child. Truth driving outward from my inwardness. Neither good nor bad. Real. No sham about it. With the first labor pains, suddenly the sun goes pale. The indifferent world goes strangely calm. I am alone. It is alone I am. Very somber, kind of sad, but very sensible. It feels like the reader is engaging in her internal dialogue the day she is giving birth to one of her many children. She mentions that this isn't her first delivery, and there's a sense that she's grudging every moment of it. From describing her anticipation of the pain she will experience, to her annoyance at the doctor who is trying to comfort her, with knowledge she is aware of, but is cynical towards as well. Despite this, she faces the fact that she is giving birth. It is the truth, quote, truth driving outward from my inwardness. This truth is neither good nor bad. It's just real. No faking, no simulation. It is what it is. And so the labor pains strike and the indifferent world goes strangely calm. I'd compare that to silence being pierced by white noise. And she is alone. This piece is very raw and almost relatable. Not the experience of labor pains, but the emotions conveyed as the poem progresses. Could this poem spark a conversation on reproductive rights, which is primarily a feminist matter? I think it could. This is an excerpt from the experiences of an early feminist who was arguably still bound to the tradition of having many children. Considering everything, the first wave of feminism ends with women and girls being allowed an education and then the right to vote. Nonetheless, the popular and seemingly only recognized role was that of mother and wife. Due to the fact that the vote was the only goal and had been achieved, feminism broke up into smaller groups, each one vying for a different cause, from labor legislation to women's health care. Some fighting did come about due to some feminists wanting laws that benefited women rather than promoting equality. And so the question arose, did the feminist movement want to create full equality, or did it want to respond to the needs of women? Because equality meant removing some protections that women initially had. From the late 1920s all the way through the Great Depression and the two world wars, feminist activism was mostly inactive. During the war, women were allowed employment in factories as nurses and some direct involvement in the war. Following the Second World War, the US in particular shifted to creating suburbs where traditional roles were revised. Women were marrying younger and having a lot more children than they did during their fight for the vote. And by the 60s, the percentage of employed women was lower than it was in the 30s. For some time, American or Western suburban life was characterized by conformity and prosperity. Not long after, the proverbial white picket fence that once secured the homestead became a stumbling block in the way of a renewed feminist movement whose sights were set beyond it.
At the present time, it's a sort of watershed, I think. Women are apparently liberated in many ways, but in fact and in practice they're not. They're still discriminated against in many professional fields, and in often in very pernicious ways. I think the time has come when women have got to find self-respect and a full identity of their own. And that's what's very difficult for them. And the battle that we have to fight is not against men, it's often against women, actually, to try and get them to fulfill themselves.
What would you like to say to thousands of women listeners who imagine that they're enjoying life at the kitchen sink?
Women unite. You have nothing to lose but your kitchen sink.
The 60s and 70s were a defining decade for feminism in the West. And this was mostly because it was lended a platform through the civil rights movement. Many of the feminists of the second wave were children of tertiary educated mothers who were displeased and disillusioned by the social structures of the time. Idyllic suburbia couldn't repress the growing yearn for equality and justice, which emanated from protests like those against the Vietnam War. In 1961, President John F. Kennedy created the President's Commission on the Status of Women. In 1963, the Commission issued a report stating that it fully supported the nuclear family and preparing women for motherhood, all the while presenting evidence for a national pattern of discrimination against working women. This evidence was to encourage legislative corrections that guaranteed equal work, equal pay, and equal job opportunities, as well as broader childcare services, thus presenting the Equal Pay Act of 1963 and later the Civil Rights Act. This act barred employers from discriminating on the basis of sex. While these were great legislative strides, they proved insufficient in making actual progress for women's rights. I want to branch out for a moment and talk about the counterculture movement of the 60s, which was characterized by the long-haired, bell-bottomed, acid-dropping, commune-dwelling, nature-loving, music-making, free-loving freaks. The rebels for a cause, the hippies. The description I gave was from the book Imagine Nation, where the authors go on to describe the hippies' cause as the cause for remaking society to reject warmongering and artifice, alienation and repression, to reflect instead the jouissance of life, unfettered by restrictive norms of a corrupt and moribund society. Having mentioned that, it's only obvious that this movement sought to emancipate and empower the woman, right? Well, no. In her book, Daughters of Aquarius, Women of the 60s Counterculture, Gretchen Lemke-Santangelo documents the experiences of women who were hippies and their experiences as the counterculture progressed. Interestingly, female hippies weren't given much attention in the evaluation of the movement as a whole, so Lemke-Santangelo sought to compensate for the missing details in her book. For one, a woman of the counterculture was more often than not subject to similar domestic obligations as the average 20th century woman, this time with the twist of sexual liberation. A journal wherein Lemke-Santangelo is mentioned reads, "At the same time, counterculturalists in the 1960s tended to accept, even romanticize, traditional gender dichotomies that cast women as essentially different from men, more intuitive, nurturing, cooperative, non-aggressive, present-oriented, and ruled by their emotions and bodies. As such, women were naturally suited to be wives, mothers, caregivers, and helpmates. Their livelihoods were in part a reenactment of their foremothers' duties, grinding wheat to bake bread, weaving and gardening, actions that were once varied, challenging and economically viable. While they are said to have been empowered by these roles, it really makes you wonder if it was just all in vain, because the female hippie could leave the Arcadian hippie lifestyle as she came into it, with a lift of a thumb and hitchhike back to the convenience and comfort of emerging America. I bring this up also because the counterculture movement was male-dominated and proved to be directionless and superficial in light of actually tackling social issues such as women's rights. Overall, I was intrigued by this because it was easy for me to lump the counterculture movement and feminism together. But now that the fog has settled, the credit for the second wave's success goes to the organized efforts of feminist activists. Let's have a quick skim through these efforts. The National Organization for Women promoted the use of the neutral title Miss, MS, so as not to refer to a woman's marital status. Women's health and crisis centers were established, Roe v. Wade and the right to bodily autonomy. Children's literature was revised to do away with gender stereotypes. Discrimination against women in places of work was heavily penalized. And women's studies departments were established in universities. This encouraged a greater discourse regarding the nature of women's oppression, gender, and the nuclear family. From then onwards, feminist ideology was far from congruent. So many factions differing and disagreeing on the most foundational concepts. Eventually, three main branches remained: liberal or mainstream feminism, radical feminism, and cultural or difference feminism. Succinctly, liberal feminism focuses on making practical changes at an institutional or governmental level and giving women equal access to these power structures. Radical feminism strives to redefine society and social institutions as it senses an inherent male bias. Cultural or difference feminism advocates for celebrating what makes women different from men and goes against the idea that women can enter spaces that are traditionally male. In the poems to come, we'll see how these sub-ideologies have influenced their respective writers, starting off with Denise Levertov. She was born in London in 1923 as a second daughter to her Welsh mother and Russian father. It is this multicultural environment that would heavily influence her work. As for her early years, Levertov was homeschooled by her mother, who would read classical books to her and oversaw the production of her earliest poems. Though she considered a career in dance, she worked as a nurse during the Second World War. In the 1960s, she married an American writer with whom she had a son. For the next 40 years of her life, she published more than a dozen volumes of poetry, 600 to be exact, and lectured at esteemed universities, garnering many awards to her name. Just as the women's movement took shape in the 60s, there was an onslaught of prominent female poets taking their lives, such as Anne Sexton and Sylvia Plath. Levertov lamented their loss, not only as pioneers of the craft, but because their deaths perpetuated the idea that poets were abnormally sensitive and were due to succumb to their madness. In her perspective, the alcoholism and mental issues that Sexton and Plath struggled with weren't signs of some gory genius or talent akin to the broken artist trope. In her own words, creativity belonged to responsible, mature adults who took citizenship seriously. That opinion was slightly altered when she wrote and spoke against American involvement in war, especially the Vietnam War. Her passionate disapproval for the Vietnam War is expressed in the poem, What Were They Like?, which is featured in many anthologies. After living in Mexico for some time, she died in Seattle in 1997. The prominent themes in her work were questions that she continuously engaged with, like the meaning of life, the issues of justice that had arisen in the 20th century, and her more personal concerns like friendships, families, and other relationships. Her writing styles take on the Welsh influence of song and speech, and the profound religious thought of her priest father's Jewish-Christian search for truth. Essentially, morality and mystery are intrinsic to her poetry. The poem I will be reading is titled The Aches of Marriage. It reads, "The ache of marriage. Thigh and tongue, beloved, are heavy with it. It throbs in the teeth. We look for communion and are turned away, beloved, each and each. It is Leviathan and we in its belly, looking for joy, some joy, not to be known outside it. Two by two in the arc of the ache of it." The ache of marriage compares marriage to Jonah's life in the belly of a whale. The poet and her spouse are looking for joy, as seen in the lines, "some joy, not to be known outside it." Marriage is not discarded as an ideal, but its confinement brings problems to women who feel an urge to work in a wider field. This was one of the instigators of the second wave, the institution of marriage and the hold it seemed to have on women's lives, preventing them from effectively participating in society. Our next poet is Mitsuye Yamada. She is a Japanese-American poet, and her most celebrated work is the collection of poetry based on her experiences during the internment of Japanese-Americans in the 1940s. She was born the only girl out of three children and spent some of her early years between Japan and the United States. In her early teens, she was reunited with her family in America. Soon after, they were entered into internment camps, where she, her mother, and brothers were held for 18 months separate from their father. Following their release, she went on to get a bachelor's degree and later master's in English literature and married in 1955. She lived most of her life in South California, where she raised her fourth children and taught in community colleges until her retirement. She has committed her life to humanitarian efforts in response to the incarceration in her youth. Now on to her magnum opus. This collection of poetry is called Camp Notes. The notes were written while she was held in the internment camp, but were only published 30 years later. The themes of her poems center around her feelings as an immigrant and as a young woman in a country that became foreign to her as a result of its sudden hostility. The poems that really stand out for me in the book are the ones where her mother is narrating. Her accent is evident in the structure of her sentences and the simplicity of her expressions. I believe the emotions and message of the poem are enhanced because you can sense that she wants to say more, but doesn't really have the range of English words to do so. As I mentioned, the speaker of the poem has an accent, which adds to the richness and character of the piece. In light of this, I will not be reciting the poem. Someone else will. Here is a recital of Marriage Was a Foreign Country by Arisa Nagai.
Marriage Was a Foreign Country by Mitsuya Yamada. I come to be here because they say I must follow my husband. So I come. My grandmother cried, "You are not crippled. Why to America?" When we land aboard, full of new brides, lean over railing with wrinkled glossy picture. They hold inside hand like this, so excited. Down there a dock full of men, they do same thing. Hold pictures, look up and down like this. They find faces to match pictures. Your father, I see him on the dock. He come to Japan to marry and leave me. I was not a picture bride. I was only afraid.
There is something really special about the simplicity of expression in this poem. The speaker's limitation leaves her disposed to being honest. There is no space to be ambiguous, and so her emotions are clear. You can pick up when she is sad, happy, expressing shock and excitement throughout the poem. This piece narrates one of Yamada's mother's experiences as an immigrant and wife. She talks about how she came to marry her husband as a picture bride. Picture bride was a practice of the early 20th century. done by Japanese and Korean immigrant workers in the west coast of the USA, particularly Hawaii. Brides from their native countries would be selected by matchmakers, who would then match up brides and grooms with photographs and suggestions from their families. The women became picture brides for a variety of reasons. Some came from poor families and saw moving to the US as a way to support them, while others became picture brides merely because it was a trend. Conversely, men took part in the picture bride process because they were stuck in Hawaii due to an act by the US and the Empire of Japan that restricted their mobility, so their only choice was to settle down. These young men came to America as temporary plantation workers, and the plantation owners espoused picture brides because they saw marriage as a moral booster that would reduce the amount of time the men spent gambling or smoking opium. The process of having a picture bride was far from glamorous. Upon arrival on US docks, the picture brides would go through various inspections, and because their marriage was not legal, they would meet their husbands for the first time and have mass marriage ceremonies right on the docks. Interestingly, some women were surprised when they saw who their husbands turned out to be. Some men would send misleading photographs of themselves, presenting as younger, wealthy, and posed with luxury items, or even a completely different person. The speaker narrates everything leading up to finally meeting her picture husband. Yet it seems that she was already married to him before he left for America, as she says she is to follow her husband, and later says that he came to Japan to marry her, but left her. Her grandmother then cries that she is not crippled and questions her move to America. The word crippled here could signify a deficiency, meaning her grandmother is saying that she has no deficiency, either in living standards or education. So why is she going to America? By this analysis, she could have been part of the group of ladies who became picture brides because it was fashionable. But we have some information indicating that she was already married, which sheds more light on how she describes the events following the bride's arrival on the dock. She describes the event in the first person, but she narrates her experiences in the third person. To elaborate, she says, "When we land, the boat full of new brides, with wrinkled glossy picture, they hold inside hand, they do same thing, they find faces, they do this, they do that." Unlike the other picture brides, she was not a new bride. She watched on as they leaned over the railing, in excitement anticipating their new lives and, of course, meeting their husbands for the first time, for whom they sailed weeks to meet. Amid the commotion of husbands and wives identifying each other, the speaker instantly spots her husband on the dock and takes to remembering that he came to Japan to marry her, then left. It seems like this was the only way to be with him again, and she acknowledges that she wasn't actually a picture bride despite going through the process of becoming one. Her marital status wasn't a concern. It was now this decision she made that was. Being in a foreign country, most likely to work on the plantations, as that was the life of many picture brides. Now, I just want to refresh the fact that Yamada wrote this poem, and she made her mother the speaker. She does a fine job of expressing her mother's dutiful nature as a wife, and that she, despite her fears and loss of comfort, makes a way to be with her husband. Her reluctance is subtle, but it was expected of her either way to follow her husband, and her grandmother is the only one who challenged it. Yamada not only includes her experiences as a young woman in camp notes, but she includes those of her mother and grandmother to present an assemblage of what it meant to be a woman in each of their generations. Her grandmother and mother's duties were to their husbands and children. For Yamada, her status as a Japanese immigrant marked her experiences as she had to navigate through society, acknowledging that there were sentiments against people like her. She is quoted as saying, "Asian American women in particular must remember that one of the most insidious ways of keeping women and minorities powerless is to let them only talk about harmless and inconsequential subjects, or let them speak freely and not listen to them with serious intent." Very important and relevant words.